very much. It says you would hear me this way, so rather you hear me than not to, I suppose. So what did he say? Well, at any rate, and I don't feel, if I feel like I'm too soft, I myself had to. I'm wearing a hearing aid myself, so I sometimes would have to turn it down. I tell you, you know, as you get older, you think, when you're young, you think, well, I'll never have to wear one of those things. And then when you get my age, and then I have to wear one, I find myself turning it down, turning it up, turning it down. You know. But anyway, we praise the Lord for opportunity to have been asked to share today. I don't think I have anything new to share with you. I believe that what I have to share is probably something that that we just need to be reminded ourselves of. Yeah. And still, it's the Word of God. I did not try to plan it within the frame reference of the theme. I feel that maybe the speaker will do will continue to do a great job, as he has already started. On that, and maybe I need not speak on the theme itself, but it seemed as though that what the Lord laid on my heart, it most certainly fit within the framework of the theme that is set before us. If you turn with me in your Bibles to Exodus chapter 33, and my time ends what time, brother?
Take Pastor Dawson's time.
Take well. I heard him say so. In order to cut down on some of the time, I don't want to take time to read. I need to look at verses 7 through 11, but I would love to start with verse 1 through 11. But because of time, I won't read verses 1 through 7. I would trust that you would read that way. It has to do with repentance of the people of God, and Moses is the person whom God is using here in Exodus to reach Israel and to help them to understand that relationship with Him. But then I see something very important here. Beginning at verse 7, you're already beginning in the middle of the paragraph, is something that we're taught in school not to do, but you know, we break the rule anyway. My teacher's got me to watch it. But notice, if you will, verse 7, and Moses took the tabernacle and pitched it without and the out of the camp, and after afar off from the camp, and called it the tabernacle of the congregation. And it came to pass that every one sought the Lord and went out into the tabernacle of the congregation, which was without the camp. And it came to pass, when Moses went out into the tabernacle, all the people rose up and stood, every man into his own tent door, and looked after Moses until he was gone into the tabernacle. And it came to pass that as Moses entered into the tabernacle, the cloud, a pillar, descended and stood at the door of the tabernacle. And the Lord talked with Moses. And all the people saw the cloudy pillar stand at the tabernacle's door. And all the people rose up and worshipped every man in his tent, in tent door. And the Lord spake unto Moses face to face, as a man speak unto his friend. And he turned again to the camp. But the servant Joshua, his servant Joshua, the son of Nun, the young man, departed not out of the tabernacle. Verse 11 is the key verse, I feel, and all that we must say this afternoon is, when the Lord spake with Moses face to face, as a man to a friend. And the latter part of the verse as well, it says, but his servant Joshua, the son of Nun, the young man, departed not out of the tabernacle. When we have to use a subject today, it would be meeting with God. Meeting with God. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for the privilege of taking a look at your word, pray your blessings upon your spirit, rather, your spirit in our lives as we be hearers. Again, as our brothers spoke earlier, that we won't be hearers only, but doers of your word. We trust that the things that you would share with us now will be that which will help us in days and years to come. Thank you for already having blessed us with these truths. Help us to continue to walk with them and share with them. Share them with others in days and years. We carefully give you praises. In Jesus' name, we pray with thanksgiving. Amen. Meeting with God. And I think one of the important things to remember that we can always learn from Moses' life, how Moses met with God. And how Moses took another young man along with him, Joshua. And oftentimes Joshua is known as Moses' shadow man. Where you saw, wherever Moses was, there was Joshua. But there was times in Moses' life when Moses was getting the children of Israel to listen to what God had to say or to obey God. When God wanted to come down and talk with Israel, and when they came to the holy mount of God, and the lightning, the clouds, and the noise of the thunder, as though it was thunder from the cloud, from the mountain, and Moses had the children of Israel to meet as God had told them to, and they had gathered themselves to for that particular moment with God. And the children of Israel said, Moses, we don't want to talk with God. God is so holy and mighty, and we just can't stand that. I'm paraphrasing, of course, you know. But we want you to go talk to God. And you go talk to God for us, and you come back and talk to us for God, and whatever God says, that we will do. God allowed that be. Moses was already their mediator, but one thing in order to be a mediator, one that would speak on God's behalf to God's people, and then on the people's behalf to God, was indeed what Moses was. But along with that, we don't have to be that mediator. God, the Lord Jesus Himself, is that for us today.
Amen.
But as spiritual leaders in our churches and in our communities, we have the responsibility to be that person who come face to face with God. But we live in a society and in a community of people who we do not find too many friends who we can talk with and fellowship with, who are willing to say, I would like to just come face to face with God. And the reason why is that the more that we see the holiness of God, the less do we see of ourselves. Or should we say, the more I see the holiness of God, the more I see the sinfulness of myself.
Amen.
And so as a result of seeing the holiness of God and I see more sinfulness of myself, then I don't want this experience. And so as a result, we back off and desire not to see God face to face. But Moses was a man that who desired to see God's face.
Amen.
And so much so that he even asked permission, as you recall. But nevertheless, we believe that in the light of the text that we just looked at, and specifically verse 11, when Moses would go into the tabernacle, and all the people in the camp would come after the tabernacle was pitched, and the cloud would appear, and Moses would go into the tabernacle. They would all come to their tent doors, and they would face the tabernacle, and they look, and they look, and they look, and they wait until Moses had entered in and talked with God. And then Moses would come out, and that would be something like a... Because if God wasn't pleased with Moses and the people, Moses would not have walked out of the temple. We know that the same is true with the priest, the high priest, when he went into the Ark of Covenant behind the Holies of Holies once a year to offer atonement for himself and for the people. If he didn't walk back out of that from behind the curtain of the Holies of Holies, the people knew that God had not accepted their atonement. And there was no joy, no relief until that priest walked back. I often think of that in the light of the resurrection we just celebrated. And I said this to one of the pastors at our church. We have, thank the Lord for, we have three pastors now besides myself, plus two others, should I say. And that's a privilege I've had in the 40 years of my ministry, I thank God for it. Yeah. But at any rate, I was mentioned in Wednesday night Bible study that how the priest coming from behind the Holies of Holies is a picture of Christ coming out of the tomb. The guarantee that God had received and forgiven the people and atonement was taking place was when that priest walked out. And the people, there's a sigh of relief, a joy that God accepted their atonement. But when Christ came out of the grave, we had no guarantee that our sins would have been forgiven. No guarantee that God would, that Jesus would have atoned for our sin. No guarantee that we could stand one day before the presence of God until Christ came out of the tomb.
Amen.
When the door was open, that was our guarantee. Now we know for sure that heaven is our home.
Amen.
Because we accepted Jesus as our Lord and Savior. So Moses was a man that who did not mind God revealing sinfulness in his life so that he would get it right with God.
Amen.
And we ought to be men and women who will be willing to come face to face with God and allow him to show me, oh God, yourself that I might see myself. Because the more I see myself, the less I'm going to see of you. And we are people who are satisfied with ourselves, basically. And I believe there are three things that really speaks out from this verse 11, along with the context of verse 7 through 11, specifically verse 11, is that I see, first of all, a seeking of the face of the Lord. A seeking of the face of the Lord. Moses was seeking with eagerness the face of the Lord. He had eagerness out of love to see the Lord's face. If you turn with me, please, to Psalm 27 and verse 8. Psalm 27 and verse 8. It reminds us of a wonderful truth here in verse 8 of David. Of course, this is not Moses, this is David. But and I see the same truth related here. Verse 8 of Psalm 27, it says, "When thou sayest, seek ye my face, my heart said," is it a talking, a communication with God, "my heart said unto thee, thy face, Lord, will I see." David says, Lord, when you say, seek my face, I know that's your desire. You want me to seek your face. You want me to see your face. You want me to always seek your will. But there must be a response on my part. My response could either be, nope, not today, Lord. I'm busy. Don't have time. I got other things to do. I have to tend for the sheep. I got to go visit so-and-so in the hospital.
haven't visited a certain person. A young person approached me this week and says, well, you don't act like you're my pastor, and it seemed like you doesn't care. And I said, well, let me tell you something. Mm-hmm. It's not that I don't care, but you have been coming to this church for a year now, 1 year. You sat in 2 Wednesday night Bible studies. Mm-hmm. You are showing me that you don't care that for me to be your pastor. Mm-hmm. You don't care. Mm-hmm. And it's not that I don't care, but if you don't want to be, then I'm not going to force myself on you. Mm-hmm. I don't want you in this church unless the Lord send you here. I don't want you here because I say come. I don't want you here because you feel forced to come. I want you here because the Lord want you here. Oh, he says, I never thought of it like that. But you see, God says, I want you to seek my face. And what God wants us to do, be like David says, okay, Lord, your face will I seek. It is that Moses is here. Moses wants to seek the face of God so that the people of God will do the same thing. Seek the face of God. So then, with eagerness, we see him desiring to seek God's face in love. We ought to love doing that, should we not? Love it. Even though old self says, no, man. You don't want God to show you up. Old self says, you live, man, 15 years doing these things and you enjoy them. And therefore, you know, don't let God take you, put them down. Mm-hmm. That's just a human term. But there needs to be that openness of love to seek the face of God. And then there needs to be the eagerness, I'm sorry. And then there needs to be the openness with God. How open are we with God?
Amen.
Do we really want the Lord to guide and direct our life? Do we really want to see his face early in the morning? Early in the morning will I seek your face. When will we desire to do that? We must be open. Moses was very open. I call this openness with the Lord. When God is leading Moses, the Lord has led Moses to the mountain, and Moses is talking with the Lord, and Moses says, Lord, let me see your face. Now, that's pretty open. Now, he could have kept that to himself. But to be open, and he says, Lord, let me just see your face. And Lord says, no. You can't see my face and live. But I'll tell you what I do. I'll let you see the backside of my glory. Now, you know, when I see that, and when I read that, I think of that in the term of Moses desiring to approach the presence of God. We ought to just rejoice today. Dr. Warren Wisby oftentimes say, and the reason I can quote him, he was a Moody pastor, and I went to Moody Baptist Institute, and so I'm kind of fond of those things, those guys, especially Dr. Wisby and others. But anyway, he says, we see, Moses saw the backside of God showed Moses, I'm sorry, the backside of his glory. We now, because of the cross, we can see the front side of God's glory. We can see him face to face.
Yes.
But that's just a one of the good little parts that I understand. So as he sought the openness, he also sought to be open with God. Remember, again, he says, Lord, let me see your face. And God says, no, I'll let you see the backside of my glory. But then Moses' face did shine because he saw the backside of God's glory.
Yeah.
Oh, how important it is to us today to walk with God in such a way that others would know that we had been with God. The disciples had been with God. They had not been to the great school of learning. They had not been to the seminaries, the whatever, of learnings of that day. But one thing it was noted of them, that they had been with God.
Amen.
And it should be of each of us when we stand and preach the word of God from our pulpits and
Sunday mornings, or wherever God lead us, even that if we be young, the point of passion these days, it ought to be known of us that we have been God. Amen. Not that you speak well because you went to a certain institute, a certain school of learning, but because you've been with God. Amen. I use excuses with Dr. Dean Justine. Some of you know him very well. When I first came to Kansas City to pastor, it's been almost 28 years now. It's a long time. And he asked me to teach, be part of school to teach, and I've been part of the Carver board for first 28 years I've been here, a board member. They talk about kicking me off, but that's all right. But at any rate, Dr. Chastain asked me to teach, and I said, well, Doc, let me tell you, I don't have these long degrees. I have a Moody Bible Institute, and I have a certificate and all that kind of stuff, but not in all these degrees. And he says, well, that's fine, let me tell you, I ran a school in Africa, and I had degree people, and I had non-degree people teaching in the school. And he says, I've seen, through my experience, many of those non-degree people run circles around those. He says, if the Lord leads you to teach, teach. And I taught for 20-something years, 25 years, I believe, most of them, 25 years. And still on staff there, and praise God for the opportunity. But I'm saying, and not saying that to pat myself on the back or anything. I'm simply saying, the person who seeks the face of God, it doesn't matter. I'm not saying we shouldn't have degrees. I'm not saying we shouldn't be trained biblically. I'm not saying, I'm simply saying we need to seek God's face. Let Him be the one who lead and guide and direct our lives. So the first thing we notice here, Moses, it says, as we said in verse 11, and the Lord spoke to Moses face to face as a man speaks to a friend. Now that's pretty close with God.
Amen.
Now not only do we notice a seeking of the face of the Lord, but we notice a spending of time with the Lord.
Yeah.
The person who sees God face to face is a person who spends time with God.
Amen.
Now again, if we're going to see Him face to face, we're going to have to see Him in the book, in the Bible.
Yeah.
That's part of the thing, of course.
Yeah.
And if we will spend time with Him, we cannot do it apart from the Bible. We've got to do it both in the Bible.
Yes.
I had a young man in my ministry here in Kansas City that had gone to a certain school, and I won't name it, and so on. And not that the school was bad, it's a good school and everything, as far as I'm concerned. But the young man, he had left school for some whatever reason he had left. It wasn't because he had received his degree or anything, but anyway, he was working in the church, and he was a deacon in our church, and I had heard about some problems that he had, and again, you just can't deal with hearsay, but I had heard about some problems that he had, and these problems would have been damaging to the church had I let him just stay there and say nothing about it. So I took him to the side and took him out to an exclusive restaurant, like McDonald's, and we sat down, and I said to him, about this problem that I've heard about, and he getting hard about it, and then I said, I heard about this problem in school you had, the same problem you had in school, and he said, yeah, mm-hmm. And then I said, well, okay, what have you done to deal with that problem? And he said, well, I read a few books, and I listen to tapes, and so on. And then that had me to ask him, what do you do for your own personal devotional life? Hmm. He said, I listen to these tapes, and I read these books occasionally. And you don't read the Bible? He said. You know what I asked him?
Hmm.
Give me the keys to church right now. Give me the keys. And then I says, from now on, you can attend the church, but you are no longer this, you're no longer that, you're no longer that. I don't have to go to the church to demote you or to disallow you. I'm telling you as a pastor, you give him the keys. From now on, you're no longer in that position. He came, he sat, the first Sunday he sat in the back, you know. The next Sunday he was up receiving an offering. I didn't embarrass him before the church. I waited to have the church and I took him to my office. Did I not tell you, you know? I grew up in the country, and my parents, when they whipped me, they talked to me and they talked to me in rhythms. Did I not tell you? And you know, I had to tell him like that. That's the only way he got hold to it. Then he, you know, he finally didn't want to obey that. He felt he should continue on. But he left the church as a result. But my point is, listen, you can't lead people if you're not in walking in the presence of the Lord. If you're not seeking His presence, if you're not spending time with Him, you know, people will know. I mean, we're not concerned about just people knowing. I'm concerned about God knowing that I didn't spend time with Him.
Amen.
God knowing that my schedule got too busy, you know? So, the number one thing to do when it comes down to spending time with God, we have to make the time.
Amen.
We have to find it, make it, protect ourselves from it. Now, it so happened, most of us may not pastor a church where we have a secretary who picks the phone up before we get it. Or have the system we can cut the phone off, you know, and no one can call between 9 and 11 or something like that, you know. I never been privileged with those kind of things. Even when I had my office at home for a number of years when I was in Chicago, I didn't have an office at church. We had it at home, so I couldn't guard myself there, you know. And then when I came to here in Kansas City, we built a church, and I had office at home here for a while in Kansas City, and then the church. I didn't have a secretary. I still don't have one. You know, almost 40 years, never had a secretary. So don't feel bad, guys. You don't have one. Great. But the point is, you have to guard your time.
Amen.
And one way that I do it, I get up real early because our folks don't like to get up early. Okay. I get up early. I leave home sometime 4:30, 5 o'clock. I'm gone to church so I can get in the Word of God. And by the time folk wake up, I've been there already, huh? So when they try to disturb my time, I've already been there. So we need to learn to spend that time with God, but do it at a time where we shut other people out, other things out, or that will not crowd in our personal time with God. So Moses spent that time with God. And so I think we too, not just I think, I know we have to. Mm-hmm. Then how we find this time? How do we spend this time? That is, I'm sorry. How do we spend? We said first of all, we must find it. But then secondly, how do we spend that time? How do we fill that time? Okay, say if we have 2 hours that we want to spend before God. Yes, in, as the speaker said earlier, casual reading or deep study. The whole 2 hours should not be all casual reading. In that should be so many minutes of casual reading, so many minutes of time of prayer, so many minutes of word study, so many minutes of deep study. I found that type of study is invaluable when it comes down to sermon preparation. But if you go on and do study for sermon preparation, every time you open the Bible, you're looking for a sermon, No, we got to get beyond that. Yeah. This has to be personal to my own life. The application must be made here before I can try to make it there. You see?
Amen.
So, see, I told you this is all something that you already know. But it's just to remind us that we need that time that we spend with God. Wherein that we are reading, we are praying, we are meeting with Him and letting Him pour Himself into our lives and our heart so that when we come before the people, that we have something to say that is from God. Not something that I say from my own head knowledge or from my own study, but that comes, that God has given me to share with him, with his people, because I have spent time with him. Meeting with God is very, very important. The third and final thing we notice, not only seeking of the face of God, a spending of his time with God, but a sharing of his joy with the Lord. Notice verse 11 again. Now we see him face to face with God. We see him spending time there with the Lord. But the joy that Moses shares here is what we find in the last part of verse 11, is that there's a young man there by the name of Joshua. And I'm not saying how younger he is, but he is younger. And he's the son of Nun. And he notice the last part of verse 11. Departed not out of the tabernacle. In other words, Moses at this point would say, now, Joshua, you watch the tabernacle. You stay here while I go yonder. You take care of things here while I go yonder. It is important, I believe, in every person's life, if you are not looking for some young person that you can put under your wings, pray that God will send you one. If you don't already have one, pray that God will give you one. Yeah. Or two. When I first started preaching back in the early 70s, you know, I've been preaching right at 40 years now and been in ministry. Complete 40 years. And my pastor, as a young man, took me, as it were, on his wings and gave me responsibilities and helped me along the way and corrected me when I was wrong and told me the importance of teaching doctrine and truth. And teaching the Word of God, and let the Word speak for itself. Don't bend it and try to make it say what it's not saying. Teach the Word. Preach the Word.
Amen.
I needed that as a young man, because I thought maybe there was some glamour in this process. And you know, get some pats on the back and all that. My kid said to me one time, I preached up in Milwaukee. And he said afterwards, of course it was a brother in church, you know, no expressions. You know. And so he said to me afterwards, he said, my son said, well, Dad, you didn't get no amens today. Well, brother, I said, well, you know, I had to teach my son. You don't have to have amens. Just preach the Word.
Amen.
And so my pastor taught me those kind of things. And so since then, I have asked God to give me some young man that I might pull myself in as long as he's willing to stay there and be poured into. Mm-hmm. You know, the Lord has been faithful.
Yes.
Three young men in Chicago, they were just young men coming up, learning through the water clubs of all places. Mm-hmm. Two of those men became pastors of the church if I left. There was deacons. Mm-hmm. The Chandler Deacon Board became the pastor of that church. And he 4 years later, he died. Preached a sermon, walked the pulpit, and died the same day. Then another young man who lived directly across the street from me, I let him preach on Wednesday night and then Sunday night, and then finally start following those guys right into the Sunday morning service. He is now a pastor, been pastoring for almost 20 years.
Amen.
But it started because I took him on. And what I'm saying here is that Moses took Joshua almost but like on his wings. And used him in a way that in sharing God, in a sense like, okay, Joshua, this is what it's like to be in the face of God. Joshua, this is what it's like to spend time with God. Joshua, this is what it's like to share the joy of the Lord. Mm-hmm. Last year, in October, I was going to Chicago, just north of Chicago, to a special meeting, and my wife was going to travel with me, and my daughter said, "Dad, I drive." Of course, you know that about 3 years ago I had a stroke, and my family don't like for me to drive much anymore, so they'll take off. My girls will just take off and drive, do the driving for me. You know, I'm going to sit there and they drive. Praise the Lord for that. But anyway, they took off to go with me. And I said, "Well, let's go early. Let's go early, because I would like to stop at Faith Bible College, Faith Baptist up in Ankeny. They have a pastor's meeting. And I would like to go a couple days with them, and then we'll go on to Chicago." And I said, "Okay." And so you guys said the hotel, well, I go to the meeting. So I went. And I did not know that this particular meeting was a meeting for helping pastors to get young men, young boys, some eighth grade boys, and on into high school, teaching these young men to be men of God.
Amen.
And I sat there and I glowed, because there are people in the JRBC who have, I think, I don't know, was the doctor, what's the name of the
Maxwell?
Well, he's president, but I'm thinking from the JRBC, the chairman, what's his name?
John
Greeley. I think he started some idea of taking these young people and Dr. Maxwell of taking it and rolling with it. And I said, "Praise God."
Amen.
You know, and that is exactly what I see here. Moses says, "Here's a young man. I want to train him. I want him to show him what the face of God is like. I want to show him what it is to spend time with God. I want to share the joy."
Amen.
Oh. And one of the reasons that young people are not desiring to be servants of God in the pulpit these days, they don't see the joy of the Lord in our faces.
That's right.
They don't see the joy of the Lord in our hearts.
Yeah.
It's a dull thing to be a JRBC. It's a dull thing to be a pastor. Because, you know, we all want to support it, basically, and so on. And we need to just let them know what it is to be in the Lord. It's not the money. It's not the finances. It's not the goodies. It's not the television stuff and radio stuff. It's the Lord and His work. And to meet with God is to bring others to meet with Him.
Amen.
And I trust that today that we would seek to pray. And I thank Dr. Maxwell for that. And I did that personally while I was there. He sent me a little email when we were at the conference that they had at the school because of the rain or whatever a couple of years ago. He got me on his email list and he sent me an email and said, "We have this Paris conference, right?" I told him, "I'll come," and I came, and I thanked him for having that. And but who am I? I'm just a person. But I'm saying we all should be excited about something like that. We may not all get a young man in 7th, 8th grade or a high school, but God will send us someone that we asked Him to, that, hey, that we can train and do something with, that we can put them out there in the world to share the Word of God and in the churches that need them so desperately today.
Amen.
Let me leave one lesson with us to move through. When Moses entered the tent of the tabernacle, every person rose and stood at the door of his tent. The picture seen several million people standing, stopping whatever they were doing, walking over to their door, and standing there in a moment of prayer and silence while their mediator, Moses, approached God on their behalf. Would God help us to stand silent and wait and watch until God is approached on behalf of millions around the world? Thank you, Lord Jesus, for this, your word. Continue to encourage us to do that which is fitting and right as we meet with you. And on a personal level, on behalf of our churches, our people, our families, our community, our cities, our state, our government, our United States, and for Israel as well. Glorify yourself, and we'll be careful to give you praise. In Jesus' name.
Amen.